Radio presents The Truth Denied, Talk Radio, with your host, Roxy Lopez, where truth never lies. If you would like to speak with Roxy on the air, the call-in number is 347-327-9997. Here she is, your host, Roxy Lopez.
Good afternoon. It is high noon in desert, Arizona desert, that is. You're listening to the Truth Denied Talk Radio. I'll be your host today, Roxy Lopez, and we have a smashing show for you today. Some of our past guests from this year, John White from the Chemtrail Project, Mike Murphy, Dennis Whitney, Howard Stein, Barb Peterson, Tom Lesher, Mark McCandless, James Gilliland, and my favorite from the GIC. We wouldn't have this show without him, Dr. Bernard Alvarez from the Just Bernard Show, and he's with us to co-host this great show today. How are you doing, Bernard?
Hello, Roxy. Happy New Year. I'm very excited for today's show. What a lineup you got.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. It's going to be a party. We're 36 hours away from 2012. Can you believe it?
No, I really can't. I'm still trying to wrap my head around this idea that this big year that we've been talking about for so many years is like right around the corner. How exciting.
It is exciting. Very exciting. And, you know, with that in mind, don't you have, aren't you doing a big show tomorrow?
Oh, my gosh, yes. Thank you. Well, I actually completely blanked out on that. We are doing a very big show at the GIC Network on the main page. We are doing an 8-hour broadcast, actually 8.5, if I'm not mistaken. And we're going to be ringing in 8 time zones, starting with Zurich and ending up in Winnipeg, Manitoba. So we will be acknowledging 2012 as it crosses the ocean and through Europe and through the United States. And I hope everybody comes and chimes in. We're going to be playing lots of party music and videos. I've been testing them all week, probably driving everybody crazy. But we have it all together, and tomorrow's going to be a big day.
That is so fun. And then do we want to talk about the Turnabout show?
Oh, of course, of course.
Yeah, let's talk about the Turnabout show, too. Go ahead.
Oh, you want me to? Okay.
Yeah.
That's because Roxy's on it next Monday. Next Monday, the GIC also, we have a New Year's tradition where the first show of every year on the Just Bernard Show, which is my show on the GIC Radio Network, we kind of turn the tables on all the hosts, and we have the hosts interview each other. So it should be very interesting. We're going to have Yvonne Weitz. We'll be interviewing Roxy Lopez, and Roxy will be interviewing Yvonne. Reverend Trevor Knott will be interviewing myself, and I will be interviewing Reverend Trevor Knott, who is the assistant director for the GIC. So we're looking forward to that. It's always a fun show and probably one of our most popular shows of the year, which is kind of weird, but yeah, looking
isn't
forward
that interesting? To that. Isn't that, now, that's Monday the 2nd, and what time is the show? 1 o'clock Eastern?
1 p.m. Eastern, yeah, 1,
right.
1 to 3
right.
Eastern.
I'll try to be there.
Yeah, you better.
No, I'm all ready to rock and roll in the new year. I'm like, I'm already there. So, yeah, that sounds great. And, well, we're going to just move right into this show. Now, for everyone who is listening and just logging in, what we are doing today is we are saying a goodbye, a farewell to 2011. And what a great year 2011 has been. And it's been a revealing year. It has been a unifying year. Many camps have been unifying together and activists. It's the year of Occupy Wall Street, where in our country and around the world, people have gotten out into the streets and said no more. And I'm sure we're going to be seeing a lot more of that in 2012 as the movement develops and grows. 2011 is going to stand out in my, when I look back at my life, 2011 is going to stand out as a very big awakening year for me. How about you, Bernard?
not only awakening, but I think a lot of cleansing and revealing. I think revealing is a really good word for it, too. You know, we've been exposing a lot of truth, you know.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, so without any further ado, our first guest who has a special message, obviously, for everybody is Mr. John White, our partner and the head up of the Chemtrail Project. And if John's on the line, John, welcome to the show.
Hey, Roxy, how you doing?
Great. And you're in Sedona today, aren't you, John?
I am in Sedona. It's beautiful. They've been spraying all morning, but it's not getting me down.
I'm seeing it. John, why don't you go ahead? You've got 10 minutes to elaborate on anything you'd like to talk about, John.
Okay, thanks, Roxy. Yeah, the first thing I wanted to talk about with everybody is I know some of the people listening are probably on your Facebook page, the Chemtrails Kill, and they are familiar with the Chemtrails Project, but anybody who is not, I just wanted to kind of give a little briefing on it. Basically, the objective for Chemtrails Project is to get everybody involved with the testing process. And what we do is we went through a long process of determining a couple of labs, a couple of heavy metal labs that we could rely on. And we then set up deals with them where we get pretty good rates, and people contact us through our website, which I'll give out in a minute, and our Facebook page. We then send out kits for people to collect rain. With the rainwater, we then test it for aluminum, for barium, and for strontium. With all of those results, we create a map, which is on our website, and the map is basically for everybody to use. It's a snapshot of the entire United States, and it shows you the different heavy metal levels throughout the whole country. What we also give the people who want to become testers is they also get a PDF from the lab, which is an official third-party lab, and with that PDF, they can then use it locally. If they want to open up some eyes and create some awakening, they can show the heavy metal levels in their rainwater. The end goal for this, there's a few end goals. One is to have a complete snapshot that we can send out to all of media outlets, politicians, anybody we want. But also it's really something where it's helping connect the dots. We all know that there's substances. We all know there's heavy metals. Mike Murphy really opened a lot of eyes to that. But it's kind of scattered. The information is very scattered. This gives everybody a way to really consolidate the information and have it as a go-to source. So that is one thing that we're doing. And if people want to get kits, they can reach us at chemtrailsproject.com, or they can go to our Facebook page. Our Facebook page also is set up so you can get a kit directly there.
Thank you,
that
John.
Is,
we also have rainwater and web testing on www.thetruthdenied.com, and I'm pretty sure people are familiar with going that route. If you click on one of those, it'll take you to John's website and give you the whole custody, chain of custody, and some directions to follow and how to order a kit. So thank you, John. That's absolutely been tremendous, what you've designed there, that map and everything. And we're getting a pretty good response, and just to let you know, we need people to continue. Yes, John.
Absolutely, we do. You know, the other thing, I'm glad you brought it up. I was going to mention too. So the first stage is that rainwater, which is very specific to the heavy metals. The other stage, which is something that I partnered with you, Roxy, on to do, is the web samples, the chem web. There's really nobody who is organized to an extent right now to collect these chem webs and have them tested. And what Roxy and I set up, which is a pretty unique relationship, is we have two different sources who are testing these webs for us. One of them is Clifford Carnicom's Institute, and the other one is another third-party accredited lab. So you have your certified third-party lab looks at it, and Clifford is like our checks and balances guy for the lab, but also for further evaluation. So we have two sources. Now, for the chem webs, we also have a trust that we set up. So that is actually all free testing. So if you're seeing chem webs, all you have to do is contact us through the Facebook page, the Roxy's Truth Denied. We'll get you kits. We'll show you the chain of custody, a safe way to collect them, and then we test them all for free. This is really interesting because, you know, as a lot of people hear little bits here and there, you know, there's things such as Morgellons, and there's things such as synthetic blood cells and other interesting biological elements inside these webs. So this is giving us an opportunity to start mapping now actually within these webs.
Correct. What else you got for us, John?
I know there's a lot there, but let me drop one more on you. This is one I'm very excited for, as I know you are, Roxy, and this is the first time we're really talking about it because we've been going through all the logistics. But in 2012, in August, it's actually going to be the weekend of August 18th, so put that down, we are going to be hosting the Consciousness Beyond Chemtrails Convention, and that will be in Los Angeles on August 18th weekend. And basically what we're going to do, it's going to be a live event. We have a beautiful venue. It's this old, historic, show house. And it's also going to be simulcast live. And unlike a lot of events where, you know, it can cost a few $100 for a live ticket and, you know, $70-$80 online, the goal is to reach as many people as possible. So we're setting up the logistics in terms of how much it will cost, but we're going to absolutely make it affordable, especially for when we're simulcasting it. You know, we want to be able to have it be $20 so you can watch the whole, you know, 2-3 day event, and you can stream it with all your friends, you can stream it with your whole neighborhood, and just have it be so affordable that we can get the message to as many people as possible. So this is going to be awesome. This is really, in my view, and I know yours too, Roxy, this is something that's been needed because we haven't really had a collective meeting of everybody that's involved in this movement. We haven't really had a collective show of might, if you will. And, you know, it's kind of, everybody's working on the same thing, but it's a little bit scattered. It's not really unified in this way. So this is going to be the first time we want to do this every year. Hopefully this will spawn other people to have their own conventions, their own local groups. And this is really going to show that we are organized, we are a collective, and in 2012 we are definitely rising above this, hence the phrase consciousness beyond chemtrails. So very exciting. Real quick, before I have to go, I just wanted to name off some of the names that we have confirmed for presenters. So we have Michael Murphy, who I know is coming up next from What in the World Are They Spraying? And, you know, Michael is really somebody who personally got me started, as you can hear from the Chemtrails Project, with all the heavy metals testing. He really opened the eyes for us and so many others. Clifford Connicom will be there. He's one of the early pioneers, of course. So is Alan Buckman. Mark McCandless, your friend, will be there, aviation expert and more. Scott Stevens from WeatherWars.com. He's actually an ex-meteorologist who's speaking out about it. Very interesting information from Scott. Bob Peterson from FarmWars.com. Andrew Weber from ExoPolitics.com. He also has a beautiful message, Andrew, that I have heard. Really about rising above this and how our collective consciousness will take us above this. Carrie Cassidy from Project Camelot. She has just fascinating information regarding nano satellites, nanoparticles, all sorts of nanotechnology within chemtrails, which she'll be able to expose. Mark Peebler, also known as Dr. Dream. He is all heart-based. This guy is really all about the conscious level and rising us above it. Laura Eisenhower, and if you haven't heard of Laura Eisenhower, I suggest you Google her, go to her website. She's a fascinating woman. She's the great-granddaughter of Dwight Eisenhower, and she knew at about 4 or 5 years old that she was actually chosen to start exposing some of the things that were right in her peripherals due to her family. And she, ever since then, has been, and she was even involved in, she was one of the early invites to the Mars Project and some really, really fascinating stuff. So check her out. She'll be there. And we're probably going to have a few more guests. So we're planning to maybe have, you know, 12 to 15 guests, and it's really going to be a blending of science and metaphysical, and it's just going to be a higher vibration event. And, you know, the last thing I'll leave you with is, this is just a general message for the conference and as a whole, is, you know, chemtrails, HARP, TETRA, electromagnetic devices, they all operate on a frequency which is a low vibrating frequency. So as we are low vibrating as humans, if we are stuck in fear vibration, then we are very much subjected to all of these things. We can get sick from the chemtrails. We can be affected by the electromagnetic waves. However, as we rise our collective consciousness, we actually raise our frequency. Our frequency will be above the vibration level and frequency of all of those disruptive forces. And so that really will be taking us to a consciousness beyond these chemtrails.
Absolutely. And that is the point of it. And John, I'm so grateful that I met you during the late summer John and I have been able to really expedite, really put things into action, and John's just an on. John, you're just an on fire kind of guy. It's amazing. And this conference, you know, like he said, live stream, the whole nine yards, in person, in LA, beautiful venue, historic venue. You'll get to meet. Finally, you know, the list goes on and on. We do have a few more people that we are working with to be in the show. John, the website for the seminar is going to be coming up in about a couple of weeks, right?
The middle of January. I already have the URL, actually. It is consciousnessbeyondchemtrails.com, and you will be able to buy tickets either for in-person or for the simulcast. And one more thing I should mention is we are planning one of the evenings of the conference. We're going to have, you know, like a gathering. We'll probably all get together, all the presenters, everybody who's there. We'll do a meet and greet, and we can all talk and exchange ideas. So it's going to be great. So look for it in the middle of January. You'll be able to start getting tickets. And we'll be doing a lot of promo, obviously. Roxy will be all over Facebook and the Internet. And you'll be able to see us. We have several months to plan for it. But I hope everybody can make it.
I'm sure everybody will. And, John, we're going to let you go now because we do have Mike Murphy on the line. And is there one last anything that you want to say before we get Mike on?
Yeah, I just want to leave with everybody. Really, you know, I know the chemtrails can really drag you down. I'm looking at them right now. They're blasting the beautiful Sedona sky. But every time I just take pause, take reflection, and just note that all of these control mechanisms are all at a very low vibrating frequency, and it's just rise above this, rise your vibration, live with integrity, and you will be above all this.
Absolutely. What a wonderful message. John, happy new year to you, if I don't
Thanks,
talk
Rocky.
To you before tomorrow night. And you both have a wonderful couple of days in Sedona, and thanks so much for all your efforts.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Have a great new year, Roxy.
Thank you so much, John. And that was John White. And now we have, backing up the train, we've got Michael Murphy. Michael Murphy, welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm doing well. Good morning, Roxy Lopez, and to all the listeners.
So what do you have for us, Michael? What's going on in your world? Where are you? Are you back in California right now?
I am back in Los Angeles. As you know, I've been traveling around quite a bit, not only screening what in the world are they spraying, but also moving forward with gathering information and interviewing urologists about the weather control application and how chemtrail geoengineering programs fit into this. As you know, and as we've spoken, they're very instrumental and actually a needed component of the corporatization of our weather. So I found out a lot of interesting things. And we've also come to find out that weather control is very, very profitable for certain corporations and a very effective tool to gain and consolidate political power. So it's been very interesting. And I really think this is the next step in terms of what I'm being called to do, because his meteorologist Scott Stevens said, he said, when people realize why they're spraying, at least one of the many reasons why, in terms of looking at weather control, it will be the epiphany, the aha moment for a lot of people. And with that, I believe that we can grow strength and grow numbers within this movement and then really start addressing what corporations are involved. And I think it's the next step in terms of holding the corporations and the people involved with these crimes, and they're definitely crimes.
Absolutely, Michael. You know, and I think that is the right direction to go. Of course, that's what the revealing is all about. Bernard mentioned the word revealing at the very front of the show. I love that word, and this is part of the revealing, taking off the masks and taking down the shroud. You know, just 2012 is going to be absolutely fabulous for this, I think, and we're just all ready to rock and roll on that. And Michael, we really look forward to having you at the Consciousness Beyond Chemtrails conference in August, and I'm so glad that you're going to be there. And I have a question. I hate to put you on the spot, but do you think that you'll have the sequel to what in the world are they spraying? I mean, why in the world are they spraying, actually? Well, do you think you will have that ready yet?
Wow. What is the date of the event?
Well, the event's August 18th, 2012.
You know, I think there's a good chance because we, from start to finish, what in the world are they spraying? Started with a borrowed camera. So people from Northern California actually sent me a plane ticket. So I borrowed a friend's camera and went up and started that. And we've already gotten some key interviews. But the reason I say that was an eight-month project from start to finish. Why in the world will probably be a little bit shorter? Because when you bring so much truth to people, it's very challenging for those who are new to this to absorb an hour and a half of facts and figures. So, again, the goal is to shorten it. So I think so, and that would be incredible if we could do a premiere. Perhaps, you know, the timing will be right. But I'm excited about the event, and the reason is this. I have found through my travels in the past year, I've been all around the U.S. Screening the film, and I love doing it, whether it's, you know, a group of 600 people or a group of 7 people. And the reason is this. Something happens when we get together and discuss this in a healthy dialogue. And I've seen a lot of local movements being birthed when people get together. I've also seen, like in Maui, we birthed the Clean Sky Ordinance, which is an ordinance, county ordinance, which will ban chemtrail geoengineering spraying above and around the island of Maui. So, again, when we get together, something at a spiritual level happens where people start getting active. And the computer's great, don't get me wrong, for sending out clips, DVDs, information. But, you know, I don't think that we should ever discount the power of collectively getting together. And I'm really excited about your event, and I know you can have some key people with a lot of key information. And that's my greatest hope. And perhaps, you know, we're going to see a lot of activism birthed out of that. And, you know, one of the things that I do when I try and encourage other people to do is really hit the streets with this message. And I started the Los Angeles Chemtrails Meetup Group, and we go out into the public. And we usually bring out a couple hundred free DVDs of What in the World Are They Spraying and hand them out to the public. And in terms of getting this addressed in the political realm and in other realms, it's essential to get critical mass. It's essential to get public awareness. And once we have that, then we can have the people at the political level will start to address this. So I can't stress the importance of actually getting out there. And even, you know, I'm a big advocate in terms of getting people out involved in different forms of activism because it's essential right now. And again, once we have critical mass, then, as we have in Hawaii and then in parts of New York, I know Long Island Skywatch, several activists together, and they passed the first stage of their county ordinance to ban geoengineering. The second stage got shot down. However, they're going to make some changes on that bill and bring it back up. So they're not backing down. And again, it's nice to see a collaborative effort in certain regions. And we can do this everywhere in the U.S. What's happening in Maui and what's happening in New York is just the start of this. But God, if we could get counties in every state doing what we're doing, we have a very good chance at stopping these programs. And it's really about sovereignty, you know. And when we address it at the local level, then we begin to see power. And I think we have to go from the local and expand out. I think that's the approach that we need to take.
Right. Absolutely. Grassroots and then unification on all the different, you know, investigators and people who have different groups and what John White was talking about, actually. I think it's very important for us to all begin to unify. The conference is going to be fabulous for that very reason, bringing in different activists, you know, that have organizations like yourself, Michael, bringing them all together into one place and then teaching people activism. You know, that is, I think, one of the biggest tools that we can give to humanity is to learn how to do this as well. and to be a part of the healing process that the planet's going through. That's just my two cents. And what else, Michael, what other travels? I know that you're going to be coming to Arizona here shortly, right?
I absolutely am. I'll be in Sedona for a screening on the 7th, January 7th, and that starts at 7 or 8 o'clock. I believe there's a Facebook page for it. I have posted it on the What in the World Are They Spraying Facebook page. I do daily updates, so that would be an awesome page to go and visit. Really quick, if I could, you know, address some of the new findings that have been coming up. You can YouTube. I did a promo trailer for Why in the World Are They Spraying, and I went to the American Association for Aerosol Research Conference, interviewed a NASA scientist, as well as many more. It's very clear that these programs, without a doubt, are essential for weather control programs. But so again, you can find that or go onto my website, truthmediaproductions.us. That video is up there, as well as a lot of other articles and works that I've done. But these programs were at a very vital time, and geoengineers are really open about these programs damaging and depleting our ozone. And NOAA just did a study, and there has been a significant depletion of our ozone. What they're doing is destroying our protective layer. And many people know just a couple of years ago we had a UV index that went from 1 to 10. Today it's been expanded to 1 to 16. And we believe the reason is because the sun now is much stronger because the ozone is being depleted. NOAA had just recently done a study. They've noted a significant increase in stratospheric aerosols. In that study, they failed to mention what the composition was. We believe it was the aluminum, barium, strontium, and other aerosols that they're spraying out, and they failed to source what the aerosols were. That was backed up at the Aerosol Research Conference. I met and spoke with several scientists who were there. All of them have noticed as well a significant increase in atmospheric aerosols. So this is, it's not speculation. It is there. The science is there. And unfortunately, the damage is there. But I'll tell you what, Roxy, rather than bringing a message of fear, we never want to do that. And I know that you and I have spoken about that. That can be very paralyzing. And I want to give people hope, because in the past year and a half, 2 years, we have seen incredible progress within this movement, and it's because people around the world now are starting to address this. They're sending out DVDs. We have strong street activism, which is going on in most cities, and because of that, now we're starting to see legislation, and we do have a chance at stopping these programs, and it's not dependent on the people who are involved and who are perpetuating these crimes. It's dependent upon us, and the human spirit is so powerful. And collectively, if everybody who was aware of this stood up and said no, they would not be able to continue on with that. And that is the truth. So we do have power, and we do have authority, but we have to exercise it. And we have to do that by leaving the comfort of our homes, by not reacting in fear, but reacting in faith, faith that we have the ability to make this change. And bottom line is this, we have an earth that we have been given stewardship over. And it is incumbent upon us to address this, because unfortunately the earth is being molested. And again, it's our duty to protect the earth. And we have the ability to do that today. So I'm actually very honored to be called into addressing this and being called into this movement. And from my standpoint, I see incredible success every day, and I can't tell you how excited I am to see the progress that we've seen.
Absolutely, Michael, and you've really contributed a lot to that, as John had mentioned, and we've heard this so many times with the film What in the World Are They Spraying? It really, really was a catalyst. So all of us really appreciate your work, and I love working with you. I will continue to work with you. You're just a delight to work with, and I love the idea. John White is actually the same way as a lot of us are in activism. We really do believe in unification and rising above all of this. So I really look forward to continuing to work with you, Michael. Is there any last one-liner that you want to share with the audience or leave with them for 2012?
Well, I just want to thank everybody who's addressed this for addressing it, and this has been a collective effort. So we've made incredible progress, but we have a lot more work to do and looking forward to working with everybody. But I want to sincerely thank everybody, including you, Roxy. You've done a lot to spread the word on this, and I'm really appreciative just of being involved in working with everybody. So thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Thanks for Happy New Year, and I'll see you in Sedona next week. And everyone, that was Michael Murphy, again, with a wonderful message for 2012. And now, rolling right along, we have our dear friend. We haven't heard from Dennis Whitney in a while. Mr. Dennis Whitney, Happy New Year.
Well, Happy New Year to you, Rox. How are you?
Excellent. Thanks. So, what are you up to? Where are you? And what have you been up to lately?
Well, I'll tell you, Roxy, and I know you and I haven't spoken for a couple of weeks. My life has gone through such an amazing transformation in these past few weeks, and I'm in Santa Fe, by the way. Beautiful day, nice day, out by the mountains. What I want to tell you, it may not sound like it really links together with UFOs, one of the reasons that I'm on the show, but I'll tie it together at the end. So maybe give me a couple of minutes, heads up, and I'll try to tie it all together. A few years ago, people that have listened to me before know that I had a bit of an awakening. What came through to me during that period of time was information about light, sound, vibration, law of attraction. All of these things came together for me, and I knew it on a very basic level. I knew the mechanics of it. Then what happened, I started discussing this with somebody that I was working with, somebody in our corporate level. I told her all about this, and she said, Dennis, have you seen The Secret? And I said, no, I've never seen that. And I didn't ask her what it is. She didn't tell me what it was. And sorry, I'm just not feeling that well this morning, though. So, you know, time goes on. And all of this information starts coming forward to me when I made a decision recently to absolutely honor myself. I had decided from this point forward, up to a few weeks ago, everything that I do now, Rox, includes just out of sheer joy and bliss, that is the only thing that I am doing from this point forth, are things that honor myself and give me joy. What I learned through this process, about this movie, The Secret, which then brought me on to Esther Hicks and her information and the channelings of Abraham, I had never listened to any of that before. And it so resonated with me. So what I can suggest to people is, if you are in a negative state right now, if you're concerned about chemtrails, whatever it is,
mm-hmm.
that you just get yourself focused, start thinking positive, and that everything will come to you in life. It's just blowing my mind right now, Rox.
Mm-hmm.
And I apologize the way I sound right now. I'm having a great couple of weeks and a lousy morning, but. But it's just amazing. I'm watching synchronicities happen in my life, one after the other after the other. And what I'm learning from this, especially with the holiday season, you're giving, you're helping people out. I went on Christmas Day. I went around and I started handing money out to whoever I could. I figured this is the best thing that I could do for the holidays. Let me give to this person, to that person. What you find is the universe returns all of that to you in a very positive manner. What you put out is what you get back. It's so important for people to realize, don't bog down on the negative of 2012. If you think something bad is going to happen, whatever the case is, rise above that and just focus on the positive. The more you focus on the negative, the more it's going to manifest that. You and I have talked about that before.
Mm-hmm.
So at this point, just focus on the positive and you know, and amazing things will come your way. And my, you know, my life is just opening up like it never had before. And, you know, when we talk about vibration and we talk about UFOs and things like that, that's all it is. You know, vibration brings us into another dimension. It brings us closer into their realm. If it is of your interest to be around UFOs and to see more UFOs, you have to raise your vibration and do that through emotion, positive emotions, gratitude, thankfulness, love, compassion. All of these things raise your vibration and move you closer into their realm. There was a book out a few years ago, and it was, well, it was prior, obviously, to John Mack's death, and it was called Passport to the Cosmos. And I so resonated with one of his clients in there, not a patient, the client. And what she was talking about was that she got so frustrated. She's trying to explain to John Mack how the person next to her could not see what she was seeing. She said, "Why can't you see what I see?" And I have used those exact words with the person next to me out at the East Eddy Field, all around. You literally can be vibrating at a higher rate or at a different rate than the person next to you. And you'll be able to see things that they won't be able to see. You are closer to their realm. So it all goes hand in hand. Put out the positivity. Focus on what you want in your life for 2012. And let the universe go out and track it down and bring it back towards you. And what comes with that is just icing on the cake. If you want to be closer to UFOs, you want to see them, you want to interact with them, if you believe they're members of your star family, all this will come hand in hand. I think it's an amazing time to be alive. I think we all chose to be here during this time, during 2012. So it's all good. It's all good, Roxy.
Of course, that's it.
How I feel. That's how I feel. I mean, you have too many people. I don't think as many as used to be, but there's a lot of people that are still dwelling on what the Mayan calendar means and what it's going to bring. Well, look around you. If you can't see positivity in the crashing of all of these paradigms, yes, it can be a little scary. I mean, it's a purging, it's a cleansing. You know, indigenous elders have spoken about this for millennia, that this is the great purification. Everything bad, all the lower vibrational attributes of this planet are about to be removed. And just like your earlier guest had said, when you raise your vibration, you rise above that. There was a movie, it was called The Celestine Prophecy, James Redfield. It was okay, it wasn't bad. But the takeaway message from that was when you raise your vibration, and if you can hold that vibration, everything will pass beneath you. Like a plane, you're just going to fly over it. You're just not even going to see it. It's not even going to be part of your reality. If you slip, if you fall into fear, you know, judgment of others and any kind of negative thing or jealousy or hatred, these are lower vibrational traits that will bring you right back down to the 3D, and you'll be mixing it up again with all the things you were trying to avoid in the first place. So the trick is, do not give your attention to what you don't want. Don't keep saying that. I don't want this in my life. I hope that, you know, the government clears this up, or the elite, or they're up to this. Ignore all that. Just focus on the positive, and the positive will replace the negative. Because as long as you're even just stating that you don't want these negative things in your life, you're just drawing more attention to it. So, I'm thrilled for 2012. I'm thrilled to be here. I appreciate everything that you've done for me as well, Rox. I've really enjoyed, you know, all the time that we've spent together on the phone, and we know it's all positive. It's all good.
Well, it's great having you as a friend as well, Dennis. And I must say, you know, for the listening audience as well, and so many people who have participated in spreading awareness and on Chemtrails Kill and other group sites like Al DeChico's site, the Chemtrail Geoengineering Lawsuit, of course, all the rest of everyone who's on the show. But I guess what I'm saying is that, you know, unifying has really given us all so much more strength. We're so much more empowered when we stick together. Ego starts to go by the wayside when we realize that we're nothing without each other. And we're all reflections, you know, we're all reflections of one another. And, you know, at the same token, you know, leaving 2011 behind us now, you know, yeah, I get a little choked up because 2011 just seemed like it lasted so long on the
one thing after the other. And you wonder, when is this going to end? When are we going to pull through this? And again, I mean, just take the perspective of when something crashes like this, when we have a deterioration of the financial system, do you really want to hang on to something like that? Let it go. Let it be. I mean, crash it to the ground, start it from scratch, and let's start in a way that's more beneficial to humanity. There's nothing bad that comes of that. And you and I both know full well there are so many technologies that have been suppressed over the years, just dying to make it to the surface. Well, that day is coming, and the learning curve is going to be very short, very quick. So when the opportunity presents itself, and I believe 2012 will have a lot to do with that, these are technologies that will then be made available to the populace. There are some brilliant minds on this planet. They've figured everything out. We have everything from levitation to, you know, operating vehicles on water. It's everything that we need on the planet to benefit each other. But first and foremost, I mean, we've got to take care of each other, look out for each other, and really keep a positive mindset. For a lot of us, we need to be there for the others that are in our family or in our friends within our circles, because we have some that are just kind of buckling at the knees about what may come. Well, don't entertain that. We're going to be fine. We're going to move through this. And if it helps anybody, you know, by the time we get to 2012, at that point, this is my personal belief. I've heard it elsewhere. This is when the rough times basically reach a crescendo in the December 21st, 2012. Everything else, it's a positive feedback loop towards all things good and positive for humanity. So if you can hang on to this ride until mid-December, and you can, we all can, just hang on through there and things get better and better after that. And, you know, a lot of it is already shaken out. I have no problems with what's happening now. I don't entertain the destruction or the pain inflicted upon others. It's just a matter of this is a cleansing and a purging that had to take place on the planet. And I also believe that a lot of us, all of us, chose whether or not we wanted to be here during this time and through these events. Do you want to stay? Do you want to go? We chose that during our pre-birth soul plan. You know, do you want to stick it out through this, or do you want to stick around and help and really be somebody who, you know, who can be there to assist others? And I think those of us that remain at this time, like yourself, like the others on this panel today, we're here to help. We're here to get people through this, help them understand this is not the end of the world. Ignore all that nonsense. It is all good. So.
Absolutely. And I thank you for coming on the show today. It's been a while. I know that you're not so big in being in the public eye so much anymore, but at the same time, you know, you have been such an instrument to so many. And I mean, don't be a stranger is what I'm saying. And it's
No. Before I take off, let me pull one quote. And James is going to be coming on, and he can talk about all the things he wants to talk about. But he has such a wonderful quote. I've spent the last several years, and it's kind of like my annual pilgrimage to the East Eddy Ranch. And every time I pick up a little nugget of information or inspiration from him. And one of the things he has said is that, you know, I spent half of my life trying to be somebody, and now I'm spending the other half of my life trying to be a nobody. That is an absolutely, perfectly inspirational thing to say. For a lot of us that have, you know, you get caught up in the ego at times and things like that, and it's always a matter of keeping it in check. It's not a healthy thing. I mean, it's innate in all of us. I mean, you can't get rid of ego, but you can control it. And to watch somebody like that and to visit one of his events, he's almost not even seen amongst his event. I mean, he's around. He's walking around amongst you. He doesn't make it about him, and I find that wonderful. And I'm trying not to make anything about me. I just, you know, I want to help the people in my immediate vicinity, help those that I can help or share what I need to share via email. That's where I'm at now, and just focusing on the changes around me at this time. And Yeah, I you know, between him and Tom Lesher, who has been also incredibly inspirational. I don't know Tom, but for anybody that hasn't listened to him, I think his videos come out like every Wednesday or so. You will watch him talk about all the things that are about to align in your life because of the alignment of the stars and the planets, you know, astrology, but he does it, you know, in a very humorous way. But when that week passes, when he tells you what's coming, all you can do is just sit and just giggle. I mean,
Tom is really, he's sweet, and he's loving, and he's humble, and he's just, isn't he a treasure?
He's on the money. I mean, he is on the money, and it, and it's just, you can't believe that anybody could be so accurate.
Scared on the money, absolutely.
A thorough joy. So, definitely give a listen
if you
haven't
before. Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, well, Tom will be joining us in about a half an hour, and James will be joining us at 45 after, right before the show, 15 minutes before the show ends. But anyway, I've got to keep moving on. This train is pulling into the next stop. So, Dennis, wonderful to hear you. Happy New Year.
Same to you,
have
Rock.
A wonderful
Happy New Year
night
to
tomorrow.
Everybody.
We're, and, like I said, 35 hours away from 2012. So hang in there, everyone. And thank you, Dennis. Thank
you
so you much
bet,
for
Rock.
Calling and giving a message
care.
To the public. You too.
You bet.
Thanks. And now we have our new correspondent who's on our show, on the Truth Denied Talk Show every week to do an update and commentary. Our new correspondent is Howard Stein. And Howard is here today with a message for everybody. Hi, Howard. How are you? Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. That's my main message. Happy New Year. 2012 is here.
That's it? That's all you have for us?
Yeah, that's about it.
Okay, bye.
I'm only kidding. I, like I said, you know, you motivated me, like you motivate so many others, so I came out of my rabbit hole, and I'm going to be bringing once a week what the government's up to and putting it out there for the people. Because, you know, the more I talk to people, the more I get amazed. You know, I talked to somebody that just the other day about do they feel they're informed. And they listed all the news agencies that they watched. And then I asked them, so you know all about the Cardassians? And they said, yeah. And do you watch the show? Yeah. When I mentioned fusion centers to them, they were clueless, never heard anything about it. And that's our media. And this is the alternative to the media, this show right here.
Mm. Well, alternative media is the way to go. You know, you were talking about the last time you came on the show a couple weeks ago. You know, we were still talking about this NDAA, the National Defense Act, and as that's evolving in the you know, the media, in not mainstream media, although I must say that on talk radio here, Fox Radio, Fox News, they are talking about it on talk radio. So they're going. There's a big debate about it, and basically, what it is I guess there's a and forgive me because I part of the bill is a 10-1011. I guess people can look at that 1011 to 1013. I guess that would be a line in the bill. And I didn't do the research on that today, but anyway, we might want to talk about that on next week's show when you come on
it's
the show.
It's a plan.
Mm-hmm. It's really interesting,
and,
this little portion. But,
I'm blessed
but,
to be here in 2012. A lot of people look negative on it. To me, it's fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a 3,000-year-old prophecy is right in front of us. We get to witness.
Mm-hmm.
And the worst-case scenario, it's a cleansing.
Now, you know what's very interesting, that each one of you, as you are coming on the show today, I want the audience to know this. We were doing a show, leaving 2011 behind, welcoming 2012, and everybody would talk about whatever they wanted to talk about. None of you have spoken with each other yet, you know, all of you that are on the show, all nine of you. No one has spoken to each other about what you were going to talk about. I haven't the foggiest. As a matter of fact, Bernard Alvarez and I were talking this morning about how, you know, this is going to be a fun show because we don't know what anyone's going to be talking about. And what's interesting is that every single one of you are just coming right out and saying pretty much the same thing.
Oh, really? Cleansing, huh?
Yeah. I mean, all of it, you know, and raising awareness and cleansing and something that we need to do and unifying and coming out of the woodwork, or like you said, coming out of your rabbit hole. A lot of people are just saying, forget it. I'm not going to hide anymore. I'm not going to hide behind, you know, Facebook, or hide behind a social media, Twitter, and, you know, with a fake name. I'm coming out and I'm going to start talking about what's really going on. So, you know, this is great. What do you think of Occupy?
I beg your pardon?
What do you think of
Occupy? The Occupy movement?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's too scattered right now. It needs to define itself. It needs to structure itself. Because if the way it is, if you talk to 100 people on Occupy, you get 100 different reasons why they're out there.
Mm.
So once it starts materializing its function, its purpose, and gets defined, then it's going to be a force to be reckoned with.
Absolutely. Now, when you say that, you know, the 100 different reason thing, you know, I get what you're saying too. But at the same time, there are over 100 reasons why anybody should be marching in the street. I mean, that's the part that I get kind of, you know, not that I want to have an argument with you or anything, Howie, but there's thousands of reasons to be out in the street, as a matter of fact. And isn't that, what do you mean by structure?
Structure means more of a structure to take on the government as an organized movement instead of scattered. More of a, once it starts organizing, it's going to be a force to be reckoned with, a big force to be reckoned with.
That part I tend to agree with.
It could branch out to an independent party with no problem and have the numbers to do it, which would really upset Democrats and Republicans. To
Wouldn't
find
that
out that they're not the only players in town anymore.
Well, on that note that you're saying that, Howard, what about those who are coming from the frame of mind now, or the mindset that we don't want government anymore anyway? The government needs to go bye-bye.
There's always going to have to be some form of organization, some form of government that does exist. But it doesn't mean we have to accept a corrupt one. Doesn't mean we have to lower our standards and take whatever they decide to give us. More, we demand what we expect from them, and if they don't deliver, we are the ones that need to organize and get rid of them.
Right. Right. Well, and this is, we've got a long way to go, too. At the same time, once we reach the tipping point, generally things start to happen pretty quickly. How long did it take for the Revolutionary War? From beginning to end?
Actually, it took quite a while, because it just didn't happen overnight. I mean,
no.
It happened from our forefathers talking amongst people and having small meetings. They didn't even have what we're doing here, where we could reach masses.
Right.
It took barnyard meetings, secretive meetings, and backroom meetings, and it took quite a while to take shape.
Mm-hmm.
Years. Exactly how many years? No one's really did a show on that or documented that. It is an interesting concept. I wonder how long it did take. But it started off very small, just ideas. And it had a tremendous force against them. The Brits were here, and they ruled with an iron fist. Those back rooms eventually overturned the powers.
And so what do you see for 2012, and what are some sort of something, I don't know what I'm
for
trying
me,
to say.
Answers
you know,
to a lot of questions
answer.
That I've had.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to find
what
out
you,
answers.
What do you, you're going to find answers to the questions that you've had all along, and then are you going to share those answers as well?
Yes, without a doubt. Yeah. Now, 2012, we all know, is a prophecy of something occurring. But it goes one step further, where our government are preparing for something horrendous. That's obvious. What it is, I don't know. Is it 2012? We're going to find out on that day. And if it's not that, for instance, a lot of people don't know that the government has been working through scientists to create a really strong strain of bird flu, influenza, and it leaked out, and the government put a big shutdown on the scientists talking about it. They took a bird flu and they mutated it 5 times to make it really susceptible to jump species. But now the government says, oh, we did that because it will be a cure. A cure for what? A cure for a manufactured virus that would never take place naturally? That's absurd. So I'm really curious on what is in store. What is? It's like a chess game. And a lot of pieces are going to be moved this year, and I'm fascinated by it. But I'm also an optimist by it, because if they bothered to look through history, a tyranny always fails. It always fails. It's never been successful one time all throughout history.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that's what we're dealing with?
Yeah, we are without a doubt going to fascism. They made it legal for the military to come to my house and grab me by my neck and throw me in a Humvee,
right,
hold me without charges, and that's going to be legal. I would say that's tyranny.
Right.
They also made it legal for them to tap my phone, seize my bank accounts, arrest me, with no warrants involved at all. That's tyranny.
Hmm. What do we do about that?
Be aware, for number one. And like I said, they're never successful in the long run.
Right, right.
They should look at some history books, and they will read about their own failures that will be coming their way.
Right. Now, are you aware that Occupy is having a Constitutional Congress July 4th in Philadelphia?
No, I've been really down and out. I haven't even been doing the music.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, I came here on the show. I've been off the air music-wise for a while now.
Okay.
Down and out, girl, but I wouldn't miss this show.
Oh, Howard, thank you so much. You know, that's interesting because almost everyone who came on the show today so far has been ill. So blessings to everybody. I mean, really, wow. I don't know what's going on. And I'm getting a lot of reports. I don't want to go into all this sickness. Yeah, we know what's going on. They're trying to kill us. Oh, my God. For 2012.
Yes.
Do you have anything that you would like to say to the listening audience, to the public? I do want them to know that you're going to
be
the show every week, so they can always listen to your updates or your political updates. You're going to keep us informed. But what do we also want to say to those who are just getting started in activism, or those who are just tuning in, just found the truth denied, whatever? What are we sharing with the public here?
Well, number one, it's time we all get out of our rabbit holes and open up our eyes, because I feel if you're dormant like I was, you're not a solution. You're part of the problem. And you're not alone.
Really,
when you get up and stand up and start opening your eyes, there's a lot more people every day doing the same thing.
True. We're not alone. I think that's a wonderful thing.
We're not alone.
Sense. No.
Not at all.
We're not alone. And what do you think the turning point for you was, where you just said a wonderful line that if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem? What was the turning point for you to decide that you were going to step into being part of the solution?
When so many bills, I noticed, taking away freedoms from people, and they just felt they could do it nonstop, and they've been doing it nonstop, I was just appalled by their arrogance. And I just decided at that point, enough is enough. This is really some evil moves taking place, and they just feel so arrogant and entitled to do this. I couldn't no longer stay on the sidelines. And the only reason I always stayed on the sidelines was because of family, you know, in certain government positions. I just felt I couldn't be involved and cause embarrassment. But at this point, I don't care. There's something more important to standing up now. than causing somebody embarrassment at their work. So be it, if that's what it does. But there, you might say there's big things happening. And if I was to shut up and stay on the sidelines, I'm part of that problem. I'm not part of any solution. So I took that turning point.
And thank you, because I know that there are a lot of people out there right now that are right at that, you know, they're on the fence like you were. And I think that'll be really helpful for them to know that somebody like yourself, you know, who has radio and everything, your own show, your hits radio show, you know, that is really quite worldly individual, has come to this place of activism, if you want to call it that, and or whatever you want to prefer to call it. So I think that's going to be very helpful for some people. And Howard, thanks so much for coming on the show today. I know that you've been off and on ill, and I really appreciate you coming on the show. And thank you for that message for the public. I'm sure they appreciate you as well. And we will definitely be talking to you next week, Friday.
I have one more message to drop real fast. Happy New Year's to everyone. That's it.
Thank you, Howard. Have a wonderful evening.
You too.
Day, night, whatever it is. Afternoon.
Bye-bye.
All right, Howard, take care. That was Howard Stein. He's our new correspondent. And Howard always blows my mind. Anyway, he really did. He came out of his rabbit hole about 2 months ago. How about that? So he's a really good example of somebody who just couldn't take it anymore and decided to come forward. Next, we have from Farm Wars. I love this lady, Barbara Peterson. Barbara, welcome to the show and Happy New Year.
Hey, you too, Roxy. Good to be here. And guess what? I'm healthy.
You're healthy? Yay! Yes. I am too. The two women are rocking goddesses. Okay. Very, very cool. So, Barbara, what's on your plate? What are you looking at? How are you closing out 2011? What are you looking at for 2012 and so forth?
Well, I'll tell you, Roxy, 2011 freaked me out. There's three steps as far as I'm concerned. One is to awake, and that's to become aware of what's going on. And the next step after that is to arise and decide to do something. And then the third step is to follow it, to do it. Follow what you know to be true and to do it. Because quite frankly, in 2011, as far as the genetically modified food end of this stuff goes, something happened that is so significant that it barely flew under the radar, and it's just not really being covered that much. And that was Scotts turf grass. And Scotts worked hand-in-hand with Monsanto, and they delivered the opening salvo on this genetically modified food complete deregulation. There's only two ways that the USDA can regulate genetically modified foods, and that's under the plant pest or noxious weed. Noxious weed doesn't work because the companion plant, which has not been genetically modified, has to be declared a noxious weed before the genetically modified one would be. So good luck on that. So the other way is the process of making GMOs. They use agrobacterium, and they use a virus, generally the cauliflower mosaic virus. That is the only thing that the USDA can regulate, is if they use those things, because those are considered plant pests. You take those things out of the equation, and now you have an unregulated, genetically modified product that has that's unregulated, completely unregulated. Nobody knows it. How can you label what you don't know? There goes the labeling movement. Okay, the second thing that happened was Monsanto now applied and got complete deregulation for its new corn. They followed right on the Scotts turf grass heels. So that's two salvos fired right there to get every genetically modified thing completely deregulated.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is the end game. The end game is a complete genetic takeover of every living organism on the planet. That's the end game. That's what freaks me out of 2011. But there is good news.
Really? Is there really part? Hey, I have one question before we talk about the good news.
Okay.
Why are they genetically modifying the planet? Why are they altering the DNA of this planet, the plasma field? Bernard just let me know that they're releasing genetically modified mosquitoes in Florida. I mean, why?
You know, if you think about it, these people, there's a combination. Everything is so compartmentalized and put in under incrementalization. In other words, they don't do everything all at one time, and nobody knows what the other person is doing. It's like a typical red tape government construct where you have one person sitting in a cubicle that's doing one particular thing, another person sitting in another cubicle that's doing another thing, and they don't think they're tied together, but the fifth, sixth, and seventh people, well, they have another piece of it, and then the eighth person comes along and puts it all together, and that's the person that knows that this thing actually makes a bomb. So that's how they get this stuff done. Okay.
It's all compartmentalized, so nobody knows what the other person is doing, and nobody has one database to go to look at the whole thing. So do you think, in other words, with that explanation, do you think that these are all the side effects of all of these compartmentalized scientists' work of art here? Or is there a mosaic here that's being built? Is there one agenda for the entire, you know, globe to be altered?
I believe so.
So there is one agenda for the entire, and so I guess that's what I'm asking, is why? I mean, are they terraforming our planet? Is this where this is all leading to? What's going on?
I believe they're trying to just simply replace what is natural and good with something that's artificial that they can control, because the egos of these people that have all this money, that are in control, there's only certain families that are just there with, if you've got all the money, you've got basically all of the control, then you just have to figure out how to deal with the sheep. So they have the plan. They know the end game. We don't know the total end game because we're all compartmentalized. So that's how they get away with it. And they're going into transhumanism. They've got brain cells now being grown on chips. We've got Cynthia, the synthetic biology that all ties into this. It's all tied in together, which is a terraforming, and it's they call it the singularity, where people and machine combine to form a better human. Now, evidently, they're counting on this better human to be able to deal with all this pollution and all this stuff that they're doing to kill the useless eaters off. That's the bad news. The good news, I really want to get into the good news, because it's, you know, you get so frustrated. And I've gotten into this, and it's paralyzing when you realize and you start putting all these things together. And you start realizing what we're up against. And then you look at the whole picture and you go, well, there's nothing I can do. How could I possibly do anything? Well, you know what? There is something you can do. There is something people can do. You can't sit around and wait for somebody else to do something. So here I am. I'm sitting on the side of a mountain. I've got a wireless internet that's hardwired into my computer. I mean, come on. And I figured this stuff out. What can I do? I mean, what significant thing can I do? Well, I can make choices for myself. Each and every time I make a choice, and I make the right choice to stand for the truth and do what is right, then I am contributing to the, I think somebody else said, you've got to be positive. That's my way of being positive. That's my way of making a difference. If I make a difference in my life and I go into a store and I read every label and I do not participate in any genetically modified stuff and I grow my garden out here and I save my seeds, And then I make most of my own food, and I don't buy their processed garbage. I'm making a difference. If I go into that store and I talk to other people and tell them, hey, you know what? Read the label on this thing. Do you know what high fructose corn syrup is? And tell them. Even if they walk away, it'll still stick in their mind. Maybe you'll find somebody else who will listen. And then the next time you'll go in there and go, hey, yeah, you know what? And I got this, and this is better. And you make a difference one person at a time, one-on-one communication. That's what you can do. And you have a million people doing that, and you're going to make a difference. You have a million people doing a garden and saving seeds to get away from the genetically modified garbage, you're going to make a difference.
That's, right.
Yep. That's where it's at for 2012, I believe.
I think that that's what, and thank you for that, Barbara. I think that's what, you know, all the previous guests, I think that's what Howard was just saying as well, you know, be a part of the solution. And there are lots of different ways to be a part of the solution. And what you just described is one way, you know, one option of many to be part of the solution. That's what you decided to do, you know.
Exactly. You know, everybody has got their own niche. They've got their own thing that they kind of get into and they like reading about, and they're going to, you know, learn more and more about, because we're all different. Let's celebrate our differences. We don't all have to be the same. We don't all have to agree. But we can all agree on one thing. We love the truth. Now, whatever path you're going to take to get to that truth and then follow it, and whatever you have to do that you can actually make a step towards promoting that, then you're going to make a difference. You're going to make a difference in your own life, and then it'll start compounding and snowballing and going more and more and more and more, and you'll reach more people and more people. And that's how it's been working in my life. I'm seeing it.
That's very inspiring, and I can also mirror that. Same with my life, and most of the colleagues that I have that just started out, you know, it really did just start with one. You know, for you, Barb, it started with just you. You said, hey, I'm sitting by the side of a mountain, like you said, out in the middle of nowhere, and I'm going to start by doing X, Y, and Z. And that's what I think everybody needs to understand, is it we're not asking you to form giant organizations, people. We're just saying start with yourself, your own literal backyard, your own personal life. Just start there, the changes that you make in your own personal life. And you're absolutely right, Barb. If you're good at writing, do a blog. If you're good at communicating, you know, or you're good at technology and you want to build a little website or a blog site, which, by the way, building blog sites today is like nothing because they build them for you now, you know, WordPress.
Mm-hmm.
So there are so many different ways, and you can make this something that's exciting to do. It doesn't have to be this long, dreaded, horrible, I'm an activist. Activism is light work. You get lighter.
It's the fun part. You know, it's the fun part where you actually get to go out and do something. And I'm a 100-mile endurance rider, and I learned when doing those rides that you prepare, you don't look at the end of the ride, otherwise you'll never get through it. You go from 1 mile to the next, doing what you know you've got to do, and then at the end of the day, you're at the end of the ride.
Instead of future tripping on it, and it is all about the progress, the progression, not the end of the story, although you can visualize that and put that in place that you want to get there at some point. But that was a really good depiction as well. It's just like anybody who runs 10, you know, the 10K, you know, they're not thinking about, they have to stay in the now, or you'll never even enter the race.
Exactly.
You know how long it's going to take. I've got quite a few friends who do marathons, and it just blows my mind. But their thinking, their mindset is really different than most people's mindset, and you're absolutely correct. So what's going on for you? We've got 1 minute with you left, unfortunately. And again, for those of you who joined the show just recently, this is the saying goodbye to 2011, welcoming 2012, peering into 2012, and what do we see in 2012? Barb will be speaking at the Consciousness Beyond Chemtrails conference that we are having August 18th in Los Angeles. This is going to be huge. So, Barbara, I'm real thrilled that we're going to be having you. Besides that, what's going on for you in 2012? What's on your plate?
Well, I'll tell you, excited to be speaking there too. And I've got something going on here. It's called the Seed Lady Network. This developed out of a need for a list of places that have no biotech interests that actually are providing heirloom seeds. Well, somebody said, I like to call them my Facebook team. They said, there's all these people have these seeds. Why don't we start a network? And I said, you know what? Fine. And Marty Oakley, she said, hey, I'm in on it. You know, she actually, her and I had talked about this a long time earlier. And people are really starting to pick up on that. So I've decided to do the Seed Lady Network, and I'm going to set it up similar to like an eBay or a Craigslist. And people will be able to list the seeds for trade, for sale. Some people will just give them away. In other words, if this food safety thing goes down and people's homes are raided for seeds or gardens, if you've been wiped out, go to the Seed Lady Network, and there'll be people there just happy to send you seeds. Pay for the postage. You've got your heirloom organic seeds. It's going to be a
peer-to-peer.
Yep. I'm excited about it. Very excited.
Oh, that's fabulous. And now how exactly, real quick, I'm excited. How are you going to get that done?
Right now, I've got a couple of guys. They're techies, and they have found a template for a website that I'm going to put up. It's going to be similar to an eBay where you sign in as a member, list your seeds, and you've got your contact information there where people that are interested can get hold of you. You can also set up your own little account to keep track of things that you've done. It's going to be pretty involved, and it's going to be all for the seed savers, all for the people, so that people are having their own little seed banks in their houses. One lady keeps hers in a gun safe. Excellent. You know,
wow.
Love her. Yeah, and so all this can't be taken down by one person. It's not all going to be a whole bunch of seeds in one spot like the Svalbard Seed Bank. No, it's going to be in each individual's houses. So if one gets taken down, hey, we got plenty more.
Right. That's excellent. Oh, my goodness. I can't wait to participate in that. That's going to be fabulous. And that's your new project, obviously.
That's my 2012 project.
Unbelievable. Excellent project. I love it. So, Barbara, thanks so much for joining us today. It's been such a pleasure getting to know you, and I really look forward to more shows with you in 2012. I certainly look forward to seeing you at the conference, and just rock on, woman, because you are a warrior. You are awesome. Thank you for all of your work.
Oh, you too, Roxy.
That's right. Yeah, I know. You're like over there cracking up. Take care. Happy New Year, Barb.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now. So that was Barbara Peterson. Again, if you want to check out some of the work that Barbara's doing, this is Farm Wars. And right now, Tom Lesher, the astrologer, we have not, he hasn't called. He's the first one that we haven't heard call in. So we're going to, the show is going to call him instead right
live
now.
Live on the air.
Is he live?
No, we're calling live on the air.
And we'll see. We'll catch him off guard maybe, huh? He just wrote me an email like an hour ago, so I don't know what's going on.
Maybe he's out. Isn't 530 Hawaii or no?
No, 808.
Oh.
I don't know who he is. But it is interesting because he's been traveling India and Bali. And
oh, okay.
Australia.
Perhaps a little jet lag has gotten to him today.
And he emailed a couple of times.
Aloha, this is Tom Lesher, and I'm sorry to have missed your call. Please leave a message.
Yes, let's leave a message.
As soon as I possibly can. Happy New Year.
There's his message.
Connecting with you. Aloha.
At the tone, please record your message. When you've finished recording, you may hang up or press 1 for more options. To send a fax, press 4 now. To leave a callback number, press 5.
Why do they have to leave so long?
Can we leave a message yet? Hey, aloha, aloha, my friend. This is Roxy Lopez calling from the Truth That I Talk Radio. You were scheduled at 1:15. You were the first of six.
There he is.
In a row. Oh, we hear you. Are you calling in? Tom Lesher?
Hi.
Hello. Hello, Tom. Oh, I see. Oh, he's somebody. Where is Tom? He's scheduled for the radio show.
Not there.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, can you hear me?
I think we have Mark on the line.
Yeah, this is Mark McCandlish.
Hi, Mark.
I was listening in and heard that you weren't able to reach your guest. I thought I was scheduled from 12:30 to 12:45 local time, so I thought I'd call in ahead of time just to be ready and waiting,
Mark,
when the slot appeared.
You just so rock. That is totally okay with me, and hopefully Tom will get back with us. He's been traveling around the world, so he might not realize what time it is. But welcome to the show, Mark McCandlish. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, Roxy.
How are you doing today?
Oh, I just got through with a monitoring, a kind of document inspection that we go through at this facility where I work at with some developmentally disabled folks. So it's always kind of grueling going through all the information, dotting all the I's and crossing all the T's, so to speak. It's just something that we usually have to do. But anyway, have you got any new plans for the new year yourself?
I do. I'm going to dye my hair blonde, and I'm going to start selling cookbooks.
Oh.
I'm
Betty
kidding.
Crocker?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we have a lot of new plans. We're growing the network. We're growing the website. We've got the Consciousness Beyond Chemtrails seminar, which you will be speaking at as well. And I'm so excited to have you speak there because you are so amazing. Mike Murphy and I refer to you as our encyclopedia of chemtrails because you are so good at elaborating on areas that you just have an amazing mind and holds a lot of information, Mark.
Well,
but yeah, we've got quite a few going on. Absolutely. And then, of course, our shows, we have Howard Stein, who's going to be our updater every week, political updater, commentator. So that's going to be something new for 2012. And we're John White and I, and the John White has the Chemtrail Project. We've merged. We're doing the Chemtrail Beyond, the Consciousness Beyond Chemtrails seminar, and we're also going to be starting a documentary here in the next January 2012. So it's just cooking. It's really cooking. Website has grown tremendously, the fanship, and we are just, you know, we're one big happy family with planet Earth. So I have no complaints. I just think it's miraculous, and I really look forward to slaying the dragons in 2012. What can I say?
That's great. Well, thank you so much for all the kind words, Roxy. I was up on your site looking at your the new format of your website the other day, and I have to tell you, it's a very, very professional, very polished-looking website. I was really impressed. I have to tell you that all the many hundreds of hours that you and the other folks you're working with have put into that website are really paying off. It's very impressive, very impressive.
Thank you.
There are a couple things that I'd like
to
share with you.
That's the webmaster. I was just going to interject that that's our webmasters, both of who want to remain anonymous, and they work very hard, and they work around the clock, and so thank you. I'm sure they're going to really appreciate hearing that. This is and our writers. We have several writers now for the Breaking News page, so it's really a collective effort. But go ahead, Mark.
Well, there are several things I'd like to share with your listeners. You know, I think I might have mentioned to you in the past that back around 1980, my father was diagnosed with liver cancer, and he spent the better part of 20 years fighting the disease. And he had a number of surgeries and was undergoing some experimental therapy that seemed actually quite effective at helping to fight the cancer. And but in the end, what we found was that during one of his surgeries, he had received a tainted pint of blood from someone that had hepatitis C, and ultimately that was what killed him, the virus hepatitis C. So, you know, I've been looking at these situations for a long time. I've been doing a lot of research. The Internet is such a wonderful research tool for anyone who has an insatiably curious mind like I do. It's a wonderful resource for trying to look up new ideas. One of the things that I found over the last couple of years is so funny, too, because I was in a checkout line at Walmart, and I saw a copy, I think it was a Women's Day magazine, and it talked about some food that helps you to fight viruses, you know, and I admit it, I bought the magazine, and I read this article, and it talked about some scientists up at the University of Reykjavik in Iceland, same place where Ronald Reagan and Mikhail Gorbachev met in 1986, but these scientists found that there is an ingredient in coconut milk.
Hello?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
you're there. There's another voice that keeps popping in. But
that's our co-host. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Hi, Bernard.
Hi, Mark.
I'm sorry. I hope you didn't feel offended that I didn't acknowledge you right away.
It's quite all right.
Sorry, Mark. What's happening is we've got some strange number calling in the show, and we don't know if it might be Tom. So would you mind if we answer it and just see who it is?
No, I don't mind at all.
Okay, thank you. So, hello? Is there someone calling? Hello?
Yes, hello. This is Tom. Can you hear me?
Tom, yes, we can hear you. Hi, how are you? Your number came in really... It came in as all ones.
Sorry about that. I had this down as that I was coming on at 1:15, so I'm...
Yes. Yes, and we waited.
It's only 12:15 here.
Right. Okay, that's fine. Everybody's in a different time zone, Tom.
I'm very, very, very sorry. Is my time up now? I have 3 minutes left.
you do, but you know what, Tom? If you're able to stay on the line, we can let Mark McCallish called in with his message for the audience. So if you want to hang in there after Mark is done in about 3 or 4 minutes.
Yeah, just reverse.
How's that?
Very good. I'm here. I'm here.
Oh, great. Thank you, Tom. I appreciate that. Okay, back to Mark McCandlish. You were saying.
Hi, Roxy. Yeah. It turns out that there's a substance in coconut milk called lauric acid. Now, lauric acid, when you consume the coconut milk, or you can even mix it in with other food or make a milkshake out of it, whatever manner might appeal to you. But your liver apparently converts the lauric acid in the coconut milk to a medium-chain fatty acid called monolaurin. Now, especially in connection with things like chemtrails and the possibility that there are bioactive agents that are being introduced into the world through this process, I thought it might be really helpful for your audience to know that this monolaurin, this medium-chain fatty acid, actually stops and blocks the replication process for most pathogenic viruses. And in fact, the research on this is so intense right now, they're actually looking at this as a cure for the AIDS virus and other really, really nasty pathogens like Ebola, the Hantavirus, virus, all of these things. Now, I went out and I bought a bunch of coconut milk on the basis of this article. And this was right before the H1N1 swine flu virus swept across the United States with all the hysteria in the media about it. And like I said before, I work at this facility for developmentally disabled folks, and I had to take one of these young ladies down to get a shot an annual physical, and they asked her if she wanted an H1N1 swine flu vaccine shot. And she said, oh, okay, sure, and And 11 days later, the exact number of days that it takes to incubate the virus, she began showing symptoms of swine flu and was extremely sick for 2 weeks. So we had to observe all the usual protocols, you know, gloves, masks, washing everything, the doorknobs, pretty much kept her quarantined in her room, brought her food to her. And 2 weeks later, I start coming down with the symptoms myself. Well, I went home from work that night, and I chugged down a can of coconut milk, and my symptoms were gone in 4 hours.
Oh, my goodness.
4 hours, yeah. Yeah, well, you know, I started thinking about other things that where this might be applicable, and this is why I want to share it with your audience worldwide, because this is something that may revolutionize how medicine is treated. The fact that you can get a food without going, I've never had any one of these vaccine shots for the flu or anything else. I just won't do it after all the stuff that I've read about these things. And I'm certainly not trying to give anyone any medical advice. I'm just describing what I found and what I did. But it occurred to me that this might actually work for in the veterinary sciences. So I work with a no-kill animal rescue outfit in Palo Cedro, California, called Another Chance for Animals Welfare League. And they take in a lot of abandoned pets and things with all the foreclosures that we've seen up here in Northern California. You see a lot of really tragic situations where people abandon their homes and leave the pets there when they move out. I mean, it's tragic. But I also work with someone who rescues a lot of stray cats and dogs and things. And I wound up last year with two and a half litters totaling 10 kittens, four of which had feline leukemia virus, which, you know, once they're tested positive for that, the vet usually just puts them right to sleep. And, in fact, the vet that I took these kittens to said, you know, he was prepared to do that right then and there. So I asked him about coconut milk. Hadn't heard a thing about it. So I said, well, I'm not gonna go ahead and euthanize these kittens. I want to try something. So I brought them home, and by this time they were weaned. So I was mixing the coconut milk in with their food, and these four little kittens were eating coconut milk mixed in with their moist cat food 4 months straight, and they also had some other sort of opportunistic infections. I think it was a Khaleesi virus, sort of an eye, nose, and throat kind of problem, you know, these little deposits around the eyes and stuff, and some ointment that I had put in the eyes. So I had them on an L-lysine ointment, doxycycline, and coconut milk for 4 months. I took them back 4 months later. I had them retested, and all four of the kittens tested negative for feline leukemia virus. Now, this is unheard of. This is absolutely unheard of. And, you know, when I think about the devastation of parvovirus and all these other viruses that can kill our pets that there's really no cure for at this point unless they've been previously vaccinated. I mean, this could really turn things around for people who love their pets. You know, I a couple of years ago, I rescued a kitten that had feline leukemia virus, and I tried everything I could hear think of, you know, colostrum, zinc, gluconate, just everything I could think of, and I couldn't turn it around. But now I've been able to do it, and I want to share this with your audience as kind of a present in the new year.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you for that. I'm sure that they absolutely appreciate it. And we're going to have to wish you a happy new year and move on here to stay within
sure.
the show limits. So thank you so much, and thanks for switching around with Tom and helping us out here. And we'll definitely have you on the show to talk more about things. We look forward to you in the new year at the Consciousness Beyond Chemtrails. That's going to be a really big gig in August in Los Angeles. So, Mark, we just love that you are part of our world. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Roxy, for having me on. It was my pleasure, and best wishes to all your other guests.
Thank you. Take care. Happy New Year, Mark. Bye-bye now.
Happy New Year to you, too. Bye-bye.
Thank you. So now we still have Tom on the line, I imagine. Tom, how are you?
Wonderful. I'm very apologetic.
Oh, Tom, don't even worry about it. The universe has a flow, and you're supposed to be right where you are right now. So thank you for saying that, though. So, Tom, Where are you in the world right now?
I'm in Northern California now. I just got back last week.
Okay. You've been doing quite a bit of traveling. I've been kind of hopping around, getting emails from you all over the place. I think you just returned from Bali.
Yes, I was in Bali for a month and India before that.
Yes, how fabulous. And then are you going to be heading back to Pa'oa?
Yes, I'm heading back to Hawaii at the end of January.
End of January, right on. And I know that you've been so busy. You are going to be on our show next week, Friday.
Great. I look forward
to
it, Rod.
It'll be fun. It'll be fun. It'll be more relaxed, and you can really share a lot more about your trip and everything and what you've been up to. So as in key with what we're doing for this show, we're, you know, as you well know, we're leaving 2011 behind us now, and now we are peering into 2012. Can you give us a little preview of what you are as an astrologer looking at for 2012?
Yes, indeed. I would love to share that.
Okay, great. Because that's what you do. That's what we want to hear about.
This is a big year. This is a very big year. It's a culmination of the of a long history and the breaking out, the breaking free from old patterns, old structures, old forms of security into a whole new identity, a whole new awareness for so, so many people. And, you know, the astrology of it is really that, you know, through the year we're having this Uranus square Pluto, and it has its seed back in the 60s when Uranus was conjunct Pluto in the mid-60s. And, you know, at that time, I think the seed was planted that we create our own reality. And, you know, our ability to create our own reality is now coming to a test, is now coming to a time of needing to manifest that idea or that principle through action and through our needs, you know, of the time. So it's a very opening time. It's a very insecure time. Where there is a need to liberate ourselves and break free from, well, it's external authority, external, you know, giving away our power to governments, to religions, to banks, to family members, to other people, and really taking responsibility for our own daily experience. And this involves, of course, there's going to be a tremendous amount of shakeup in the exterior world. You know, in the governments and in our in who we have depended upon in the past. So it's the analogy that I like, you know, that just came to me, you know, is just really, it's kind of like the chicken breaking out of the egg.
Mm.
You know, it's like crack, 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 crack. You know, we kind of crack crack this egg open. And we're blinded by the light, and there is a whole big, huge world out there. There are many forces. There are many, you know, natural laws that we're not aware of, and they are really powerful. And we're kind of innocently, naively kind of opening up, and it's a very insecure time. It's a time when the shell, the egg that has held us and protected us, is no longer there for us. And so people can be going through, you know, personal crisis, financial crisis, relationship crisis, all these things that we have kind of depended upon. It's like the end of codependency and this birth of a need to really be creative within and from our core self. So it's very powerful time for, you know, the new, and those who want to risk and gamble and step forward and create a life for themselves, you know, this is the energy that is going to be, you know, supporting those kinds of new initiatives. And those who are wishing to hold on to or duck and cover or just, you know, hang on to, you know, this house or this relationship or, you know, this form of identity, you know, then they're going to experience, you know, a bit of a loss. And, you know, as these forms and structures break apart and fall away. Yeah. So
yeah.
It's very exciting on the one hand, and it's going to be very terrifying on the other hand, depending upon your, you know, your approach. And, of course, my approach is one of a spiritual nature, that it's necessary, you know, during these times to identify ourselves so much more so with our infinite spiritual potential, as opposed to our limited third dimensional ego that is living in this separate world. And so there are different forms of meditation, yoga, and different things that you can do to tap into, you know, and identify yourself, not so much with, you know, what you do for a living or what family you came from or what country you came from or what religion you are, you know, but to really move into a new place of identity. It's almost like
and,
the ego. The ego is the manager of the store, and we want to get in touch with the owner of the store. You know?
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. So.
So, do you think that humanity is having an identity crisis?
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. That is particularly, you know, where this is going. I mean, basically, we are opening. We are moving into this place of self-realization, and part of that self-realization is becoming a co-creator with Source. And that involves, you know, it's almost like life is supporting us in being able to offer different options. And I want to just encourage people. I mean, there's a couple of things that I wanted to bring up. Number one is the movie Thrive. If you haven't seen it, it's definitely a must-see, and it's more than just a movie. It actually lays out, you know, the way that the world is existing now and what is possible here coming up forward in the future, because what's going to be happening with Pluto in Capricorn is the destruction. Pluto is the evolutionary force of annihilation. It's like Shiva. And it's destroying Capricorn, which is external forms of authority and structure and control. And we're going to be seeing this year the collapse, you know, of many institutions, the collapse of many, you know, banking systems and governments. And there's going to be, you know, I don't want to say mass hysteria, but, you know, there's certainly a lot of questioning that's going to go on, who to trust and, you know, where is my next meal coming from and where's my next dollar coming from, and these types of things. And I want to really encourage people, it's really up to us as co-creators to initiate this change and to not be waiting, you know, or hiding or hoping that it's going to stop or somebody else is going to do it or this, that, or the other thing. It's very necessary for us to take action. You know, all the planets are now in direct motion for at least the next 3 weeks. And this is a time of initiative, a time of acting. And this time of acting and initiative, I just want to encourage people to put their energy, time, attention and resources into new projects, and to withdraw ourselves from it's almost like, you know, we've been playing Monopoly for a couple of thousand years, and it's time to stop playing Monopoly and go and play volleyball. So, you know, because you know what, you know, these banks aren't just going to go away by themselves, right? You know, it's like you take your money out of the bank. You stop participating in, you know, institutions and activities that are not a part of the future, that are more a part of the past. Yeah? And you stop using your charge card. You know, it's just like, you know, if you want these things to go away, if you see these as limiting factors, you know, then it's necessary to really innovate and withdraw. It's like stop playing the game and create a new game. And there's plenty of new games out there already being, you know, like the Scribe Movement has a website where you can get all involved in all different kinds of new projects and new ideas. You know, I think of the Kickstart program that's, you know, on the internet, you know, where if you want to, you know, burn a CD or you have a project, you just put it out there and get donations, you know, from people. Instead of going to a bank and borrowing money, you know, it's really time we're moving into this age of Aquarius, which is about community. It's about really realizing our oneness with each other. And this community, this reaching out, you know, to people through the heart center, yeah, really, really realizing that we support each other in a very real sense. It's got to, like, come down to earth and out of this idea, principle, theoretical, spiritual realm and get, you know, really come into action. So this is a year of action, of acting upon what so many of us have been feeling and knowing on so many different unconscious levels. You know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely, and you said it so eloquently. I'm so glad that you've come on the show. Mahalo nui loa for all of your services. I hope that you do realize that I'm a third generation in Hawaii, so we'll talk about that another time. But love what you said. Your heart is so opened, and I'm sure the audience appreciates every word. I've just been sitting here just absorbing. It's so easy to just swallow everything that you just said. And thanks again. And we will be speaking with you for a whole show next week, Friday at noon. So we'll have much more time to go into this as well. Tom, that was a beautiful message for the listeners. Thank you so much.
You betcha. Well, thanks for having me, Roxy. Look,
you are welcome. We'll be speaking with you next week, and ha'ole maki hiki ho.
All right, mahalo, aloha.
Aloha. So that was astrologer Tom Lesher, and you know, he made it to the show, so that's excellent. And now we are going to get a hold of James Gilliland. Hello?
Hello.
I'm hearing stuff going on in the background. What am I hearing?
Oh, you're probably hearing. I'm in Mexico, the land of loud.
Oh, okay. You need to turn off the show now, James. That's what I'm hearing, the show coming back. Did you do that?
Hello.
Hello, James?
Stuff going on in the background. What am I hearing?
Okay, can you turn the show off? The show off in the background. Is there any way to do that?
Yeah.
Okay. And I think that's what was coming through. James Gilliland, welcome to the show from eSETI. Happy New Year, ha'oli makahiki ho. How are you?
Oh, doing great. Feliz Navidad and what is it? Año Nuevo or something? I don't know what.
Feliz Año Nuevo.
So, James, you're in Mexico. What are you doing in Mexico? And what's your message for the people for 2012? What do you see? What's coming? What's up? And anything else you want to share with the audience?
You know, all of your guests that you've had on have just been amazing. And you know, I was sitting here thinking about what am I going to say, and almost everybody said it for me. But, you know, it's nice. It's really nice to see so many people on the same page, you know, doing things in their own unique way. And that's, you know, basically really what it's all about, is everybody doing it in their own unique way and becoming sovereign and leading themselves, you know. I always tell people, if you're seeking, you're leaking. You know, we're like these batteries, and we're always looking outside of ourselves rather than going, you know, within ourselves. And that's what I see 2012 as. It's a time of sovereignty. It's a time of getting your own inner guidance going and getting as clear as you can, and then moving on that, you know, on that inner guidance with loving detachment. You know, let go of the past, the old world, because, you know, it is falling apart. You might as well just allow it to go where it needs to go and then move forward, you know, and move on with the new world, create the world the way you'd like to see it.
Absolutely. I think everybody said that today, and we all feel that way. And it's a great message for the listeners, and it's a great message for the people around us to hear that we can actually do this. And the only way we're going to, you know, this is the collective now, but it does start, like Tom was saying, and I think Dennis had mentioned this earlier, it does start with an individual motivation and an individual change, you know, within one's heart. And from there, we can be collective. We can get the help from everyone around us, not only everyone around us. And you know this better than I do, James. We've got a whole celestial body out there of individuals that will help us, right?
Yeah, they came and flew over Mexico here while I was here for Christmas. And I said, what a nice Christmas present. They filmed a beautiful mothership right over Mexico, and then it split into two. It's on YouTube, some really good footage, but we're just getting phenomenal footage at the ranch with massive UFOs flying over real close and personal and, you know, powering up and lighting up everybody on the ground. And we've had as many as 300 witnesses out there when these ships come in. But one thing I want to caution people about is there's, you know, a lot of information out there that they think everybody thinks they're going to be saved and they don't have to make personal changes or rise to the occasion. And, you know, as long as you've got fear and aggression going and any kind of victim patterns and things like that, it's very hard to communicate, let alone even stand in the presence of these beings. So the main thing we need to do is rise to the occasion, find different ways of healing any old wounds and traumas and wrong conclusions from past experiences, you know, releasing the past, do our meditation time. And I think all of your listeners, the best thing they can do right now is to just, you know, focus on love and joy and bliss and send that out to these higher dimensional beings with the intention of help, you know, put it out there and say, you know, I'm asking on behalf of humanity, the earth, please help us get through these times, get through these changes, because it's imperative that our will is involved and that we initiate the process.
Absolutely. That's a great way of saying it, that we are the ones that initiate the process. Absolutely. Well, you know, in 2011 was a lot about this self-accountability. You know, I think we were all out rah-rah-rahing at each other, you know, wake up, you know, and wondering, why isn't this working? When we yell at people and say, wake up, why aren't they waking up? You know, and that's part of it. I think you said it so eloquently, James, that it's an individual awakening and we need to be the initiator of that, right?
Yeah, you know, so. When you're pointing finger at people saying, wake up, you know, the old saying, there's three fingers pointing back. And if you're awakened, your aura is going to affect everybody, you know, their fields. Because, you know, the unified field and that unity consciousness program that's coming through right now, the ninth wave that came through big time in March is still at play, and it's still building exponentially, and that's what is taking down this program of tyranny. It's not frequency specific to the earth anymore, and you know all these old programs are not frequency specific. So even the people involved on the highest levels their bodies are failing. Their empires are crumbling. Everything is just being taken down, mainly because it's not in alignment with where the earth is going. And she's evolving. You know, she's moving to the next level, and we have to go with the flow.
Absolutely. And I rather, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you rather just go with the flow?
Well, you know, either way, I'm all for getting teamed up or going with the flow. Either way.
Yep.
There's times I've said, get me off this planet. These people are crazy.
Sure.
Yeah, and there's other times, you know, when I'm just doing all I can to turn things around, you know. And I have my own ups and downs. You know,
sure.
Sometimes you're so, you know, it's so incredible. Like down here in Mexico, I'm teaching teachers here, Yi Gong and some very ancient practices. and they're teaching the kids all about nature spirits and fairies and UFOs and everything, and they're teaching this in the schools here, and medicine wheels and Native American ceremonies, which really gives me hope. And, you know, I wish that could be carried out to a lot of other schools and a lot of alternative schools. And they've actually allowed me to show the ancient history of UFOs and how they tie in to our historic past in the schools here, even down to the elementary school.
Absolutely. Now, are you going to be documenting this on your website or anything like that, James?
You know, I'm the worst one at documenting things. I'm a doer.
Right.
And I'm really bad about that. I'm always being chastised by not documenting things or not even speaking about the books I've written or the DVDs or anything else, because I'm just more of a doer and focused in service mode.
Oh, I was just asking for the listening audience, that's all. And James, we're going to wrap up the show now. I can't even believe this 2 hours went by. Is there one last anything that you want to say to the listening audience?
You know, the main thing we have to get over is the fact that there is no other.
What does that mean?
There is no other. Like, everything's connected, everything's one. You know, we're all of the same source. We all came from the same source. And we need to transcend all the religious and cultural boundaries and start acting as one people, you know, honoring the uniqueness. I mean, that's great. But, you know, there really is no other. All the ancient cultures, you know, the Native American cultures, they don't have a word for I. It doesn't exist. And that's where we need to get back to.
The we.
The we.
Wow, that is awesome. Well, you have a wonderful time in Mexico. Thanks so much for being a part of this wonderful show as we leave 2011 and enter into 2012. We really appreciate it. I'm sure that we'll be talking to you during the year, James. So thank you so much for being here. Have a wonderful new year.
All right. Let's make this one a good one.
Let's do it.
All right. Take care.
Thanks, James. You too. And that was it. That was James Gillen. So we had everybody to the show. That was John White from the Chemtrail Project, Mike Murphy from What in the World Is Spraying, Dennis Whitney, Howard Stein, Barb Peterson from Farm Wars, Mark McCandlish, Tom Lesher, James Gillen, and Bernard Alvarez. Last but not least at all, what's in your world and what's on your slate for 2012, and what would you like to share with our listening audience?
Well, first of all, everybody, like James said, everybody has said just about anything that I would ever consider sharing with everybody for today's show. But, you know, I love what he said about the idea of that James said, that we have to acknowledge that we are one collective consciousness with individual perspectives. And that is going to be my motivation for the year 2012, especially with the GIC. With GIC, we've been reaching out. We're bridging. You know, we talk about unifying. We're creating the bridge groups with other, you know, whether you want to call them leaders in the consciousness movement or the truth movement or whatever the word is of the day that we use. But we're going to be focusing on creating more unity with other organizations as well. As you know, we have Collective Evolution. Of course, we have the Truth Denied. So that'll be the big thing for me. Also, the beginning of the year, I want to get everybody ready for 2012 at the beginning of the year. So I will be starting a new video series on YouTube. It's going to be a 5 or 6 part series on awakening the light body and doing the work. It's not just watching videos. It's not just your 5-minute meditation in the morning. It's consciousness work. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to cover, you know, how to ground yourself, how to go between your thoughts, how to release those emotional hang-ups that we have, getting over the fear, and also as well as, you know, learning how to vibrate our cellular structure in a higher, better, in a better way, a higher vibration. And then the best part is expanding that light, expanding that collective connection with everybody. So we're looking forward to putting that together for everybody. It will be out in the DVD, of course, probably in the spring or early summer, but it'll be online for free until then. So I'm looking forward to that. And as far as my message to everybody is, Well, I hate to, I don't hate to, but I don't like to quote biblical sayings, but I will say this. Jesus was right. Treat your neighbor as yourself. And I think that's the most important thing that we need to do right now. It is a time to create one giant global neighborhood.
And absolutely.
Happy 2012 to everybody.
Happy, absolutely. And hugs to you, Bernard. Thank you so much for allowing us this space every week to do these shows and talk about the truth and spread awareness, et cetera. We've already heard what I'm going on, you know, to do in 2012 with the collective thoughts as well, with working with all the different camps. I'm so excited. I'm so excited to see how we're all going to grow. And I love you, Bernard. Thank you for being my brother in this. And you're just a dear heart to me. So thank you so much. And as we leave 2011 behind, I look forward to 2012 with you, honey.
Gotcha, sister.
All right. Well, what a great show. And I thank all the guests for coming. Thanks for everybody and all your words of wisdoms that you are giving us. Thank you. The Truth Denied Talk Radio. I'm Roxy Lopez. That was Bernard Alvarez with me today, co-hosting. Ha'ole makahiki ho.